The striking thing, at least about the 64 paper, is that he defines something that he calls inclusive fitness, which is an absolute swine to calculate if you've ever tried it in practice. It's awfully easy to get it wrong. But it's a measure that you can put on an individual organism such that if you take a group of a population of organisms and ascribe to each one its inclusive fitness, or each kind its inclusive fitness, it will correctly predict what will happen to the population. And he, with certain restrictions about that he's very clear about and makes very explicit in his paper, he succeeds in this task. He does find a measure that you can ascribe to an individual which will then predict. But I think I, certainly you from your writings and others, have found it a very hard way to think about the problem. It's much easier to think about, if I was a gene, what would I do? And I have to say, when I think about what I think of as a Hamilton-type problem, I do say to myself, if I was a gene, what would I do?
Oddly enough, that's what he did in 1963, in a short paper in The American Naturalist, which predates the Journal of Theoretical Biology papers you're talking about.
Yes, just so.
He says just that.
So it's very strange. And I don't understand why he, if in a sense, drew back from the 63 model and presents this very, very much more difficult model. I think his ideas would have been accepted much quicker. Perhaps, it's hard to say. You must remember that prior to 63 and Hamilton's paper, all population genetics models had been based on the notion of ascribing a fitness to an individual or to a class of individuals. And indeed, one was taught that you must not ascribe fitnesses to genes. I mean, even Haldane, I can remember effectively saying that in his lectures. One ascribed fitnesses to genotypes, but not to genes. So in his 63 paper, when he talked about the gene-centred way of looking at it, he was departing from an orthodoxy. But what I'm curious about is, did he draw back from the gene-centred view because he thought his views would be more readily accepted if he cast them in an individual selection, individual organism kind of model? Or did he... I have a feeling, reading the paper, that it was a deeper reason than that. That he had been, I think he was actually a student of R.A. Fisher's. He certainly was much influenced by R.A. Fisher. He wanted to save Fisher's fundamental theorem of natural selection. Now, I regard Fisher's fundamental theorem of natural selection as either false or trivial, depending upon how you interpret it. But for anybody who's been a student of Fisher's, it's a holy grail. I mean, it's very interesting how we divide on this one. I wouldn't care throwing the theorem away and forgetting it. I don't think it's fundamental at all. But I think Bill does, or certainly did, think it was important and fundamental and wished to save it. And the only way you could save it would be to find some new way of defining fitness so that it remained true. So I think he had a more important reason than just wanting his views to be readily acceptable for sticking to. But it really would be interesting to sit round a table with him and sort this one out, because it's his other thread, which goes back to George Williams in 66 and to Your Selfish Gene book, which really has made the gene-centred view, I think, of seeing the world the way we all do it now. I mean, is that the way you see it? Mm. I mean, that really is the way we see the world, and it's now led on to a whole world of intragenomic conflict, of really a world which is looking at genes as the units of evolution and selection. It's really very odd that he didn't immediately follow up the 63 formulation and, if in a sense, stuck with what to me is a more old-fashioned formulation. Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting problem. Mm-hmm.